everything that I know says I gotta go, tired of going solo. But I'm never gonna go there again. This is what it is, this is who I am, this is where I finally take my stand. I didn't wanna fall, but I don't have to crawl. I'm not the one with two star hands. Giving him the best of everything that's left of the life inside this man. I've been born again.
Yes. Do you recognize the theme weekly?
Yeah.
I've been born again.
Amen.
Newsboys, Michael Tate. Hey, yeah, I want to start this week. I was pretty hard on the NCAA committee last week or whenever last we spoke about the whole dropping OU down so far.
Well, the whole Big 12.
I still don't think they're right. I still think they're wrong. But then what does OU do? They blow it last week against Baylor. So we'd have had a better argument had they won last week against Baylor. But anyway, it's just one of those deals that I just get so upset. I was looking at the records of all the teams, okay? Mm-hmm. Houston is now in the top 20. Or I think they moved up into the top 20, at least top 25.
Yeah.
Cincinnati's up there.
Ooh.
Well,
okay, rivals.
So Houston has lost one game. Mm-hmm. One game this year. Do you know who that was to?
Hmm.
I'll help you. I'll give you a hint. it's Texas Tech.
Yeah.
Okay. Then you go down the line in the Big 12, mm-hmm. and the teams in the Big 12 have good records. The only games really they've lost were against other Big 12 teams. Yeah. So, whereas Ohio State, who is now up in the bowl qualifying, they lost to
Oregon.
UCLA. Oh, yeah, Oregon. I'm sorry. Right. Yeah. Correct. They lost to Oregon. And so, but Oregon then turned around and lost to Stanford, who has a 3-5 record.
Yeah.
Aren't anywhere recognized. Okay. That whole Pac-12 is a mess.
Yeah. I'll make one exception to your grandiose view of the Big 12.
Okay.
Texas. They're pathetic.
They've disappointed.
Yes.
Yeah,
they were touted as being the one who could take down the Sooners.
Well, they always are. But see, that's the whole...
Right? Yeah.
Yeah. For some reason, people don't like the Sooners. They hate Texas Tech.
Mm-hmm.
They love Iowa State for some reason as well.
Until Tech beat them.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
But, well, they still love them.
Yeah.
In fact, did you see where the two announcers got suspended? Because they called out the referees for the terrible officiating. Oh yeah. And they said the unspeakable.
Oh?
They said that the Big 12 wants Iowa State to go, not undefeated, but with minor losses to boost them and make the OU Iowa State situation a better.
Yeah, probably better, because.
Which is today, by the way. They are playing each other today.
According to Northeastern bigotry, Iowa State's probably the least Southern hick bigoted school.
Yeah.
Because they're Iowa. They're a northern state.
Yeah,
maybe. Yeah.
Well, I don't know if they're northern, exactly. And I have nothing against Iowa State, particularly if you look at the fact that that's where George Washington Carver went to school.
Yeah.
Back when black people couldn't even go to white schools. They did let him in. He worked in the cafeteria. That's how he got his way through school. But that's for another week. That's for another discussion. I'm just saying, I'm so ticked off at the whole way they do things in the, the Big 12.
Yeah.
Because, and not just the Big 12, it's the sport. In fact, I've often said that the sports media is worse than the news media.
Yeah. Can I ask you to clarify? Which two announcers, which game? Was it the Baylor game?
No. It was the Texas Tech, Iowa State game.
Because the Baylor game, the announcers on TV, Y. Henry, were very outspoken about how they screwed up the end of the game.
Right. Well, that's a different thing. They were actually questioning calls.
Oh,
they were basically saying that the referees were missing calls on purpose.
Well, they were in that game. Right, but this was at the very end.
I heard it.
The crowd's on the field. But here's the thing. the announcers were all wrong. Afterwards, when you talk to the coach, they explained strength of a win is important, and that's why the coach called a timeout to kick a field goal.
I understand, but they didn't question the referees. They questioned the coach, the Baylor coach.
Oh.
You can say anything you want about another coach.
No, I thought they were critical of the referees too.
Well, a little bit, but it was different. It was just they weren't questioning, impugning the judgment on calls.
Yeah.
These guys were just downright outright saying, you guys are cheating. I mean, basically, I mean, they were basically telling the referees that they were cheating. They were calling it out. And I'll tell you, it looked pretty obvious that the refs were trying to help. And at some point, though, even they have to give up. I mean, Tech just ended up Iowa State blew it and they lost.
Yep.
So you couldn't do anything else. But anyway, just saying that, it's just it's one of these deals where I get really upset at the way the sports media and you know, here's a fact. Originally when the BCS came, I remember they had the computer.
Mm-hmm.
The computer models.
Right.
And they picked the winners, mm-hmm. who was going into the playoffs.
And people weren't happy with that.
They got rid of it. You know why? Because then they couldn't rig the system. No, it's true.
Yeah, it's true.
Because if you look at strength of schedule, games played, and who beat whom, mm-hmm. and who lost and what, Ohio State wouldn't be there.
Yeah.
Alabama wouldn't be there. There'd mm-hmm. be several teams that are not there. Mm-hmm. And Big 12 would probably have three teams up there.
Yeah.
Because of who they've beaten and how they've beaten and all of that. So but that would just drive, and it did drive the sports media nuts. And so they said, no, we got to give these sports writers, and there's a definite bias against Middle America. Yeah. It's the same as everything
and
else.
And let's just face it. College football is a multi-billion-dollar business. They are a professional league. They have franchises, and those franchises are looking out for their bottom line, their dollar.
And that's why they're paying players now.
Yeah.
The college players.
Well, that's about the only humane thing they've done out of it.
It's true. No, it's true. I have mixed emotions about that, or mixed feelings. But again, back to the whole deal of fairness and just doing it right. It brings me back again to last year. We may have talked about this in the bowl season.
Mm-hmm.
The Big 12 lost one bowl game. They had 6 or 7 of their 10 teams bowl eligible last year, and they won almost every game, and including SEC teams they beat.
Yeah.
But what happened? Crickets.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to say anything. They're so, and I'll tell you why Oregon's there.
Mm-hmm.
Because in past years, no Pac-12 team has been in the past 2 years at least, if not three.
Yeah.
No Pac-12 team has made it.
Yeah.
So they're trying their best to represent the Pac-12, and we'll just leave the Big 12 out this year. Well, I said, why not leave the Big 10 out?
Yeah.
Why not have one SEC team?
Right.
But ESPN owns the SEC.
Yes, exactly.
So that's what... So
that's just it.
Suspend me. Find me.
I want to say, if you are an OSU fan, next week's game, now assuming Baylor, OU, and OSU all win this week, let's just...
But you forget who OSU is playing today.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, assume they all make it over this hurdle.
Okay.
Okay? Then whoever wins between OU and OSU next week, whichever wins...
Should be.
Okay. If I'm a Baylor fan, next weekend I'm up at Stillwater rooting for OSU. And I'll tell you why. Because if OSU beats OU, then Baylor wins the tiebreaker against OU because they beat them outright in a two-way tiebreaker. Both would have two losses. Okay. So if OU wins next week, okay, they're in the championship game, OSU also goes in and Baylor's out because OSU beat Baylor. And so the tiebreaker goes to OSU. So if...
Are you following this at home?
So what I'm saying is if OU wins the next 2 weeks and then it's an all-Oklahoma Big 12 championship and they just have a rematch a week later or is it 2 weeks up? But anyway, in the Big 12 championship, it becomes a rematch of the previous game.
I really question, though, whether OSU will win today.
Who are they playing? Oh! Hey, Texas Tech has proven they can bring the game.
Well, yeah.
A few times a year.
Yeah, that's right. No, I do have to say this, though, and I hate when they're the spoiler.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I almost want them to lose.
Yeah.
Because all they can do is mess up OSU and mess up the Big 12.
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, I really feel... Just like Iowa State has done so many times in the past.
Oh, yeah.
Remember when Oklahoma State was number one?
Sure.
Then they shot him down. And then Tech, in a few instances, has done the same thing to OU, and OSU has done it to OU. So it's one of those deals. But I really hope that somebody represents. And of course, they're all bowl eligible. Even Tech, they became bowl eligible in their win last week against Iowa State. So you have all of these teams that are now bowl eligible. And if they go into the bowl again and win again, then, of course, we'll see which conference really is the stronger one.
Yeah.
And I hope they match us against SEC and Pac-12 teams, and even Big Ten teams.
Yeah.
Because that'll be a good match. By the way, Ohio State, the other OSU, they've got...
Michigan and then Michigan State.
Well, they're playing Michigan State today.
Yeah, Ohio that's right, Stadium. The other way around.
So we'll see what happens there in that game, because Michigan State could be the spoiler up there. Of course, then they'll want to stick Michigan State back up. It's a mess, and we've spent entirely too much
time. I do want to say I have a certain fondness for Iowa State. I have family that's graduates there, and my wife's great-great-grandfather was the founder of the medical school, Dr. Carter.
Wow.
So we got, we got a little bit of I'm married into it.
You married into it. I like the school. I've always pretty much liked the school.
Mm-hmm.
I just have a hard time with that coach.
Mm-hmm.
And there's something about him.
Yeah.
It's like the New Orleans Saints coach.
Mm-hmm.
There's just something that a vibe.
All right.
Of course, that's for another time, way other time.
This is a good sports podcast. We should get into politics if we got nothing better to do.
Yeah, we should be. All right. How about this? ABC, CBS, NBC, CNN, among others, they skip the whole story about the whistleblower revealing the threat to parents by the DOJ.
Yeah.
The DOJ, for those of you that don't know, Merrick Garland launched an investigation into the parents. They wanted to spy on the parents that were critical of critical race theory.
Yes, they're doxing them.
Right. And this was, I mean, can you imagine the Department of Justice spying on the phone records, on communication of parents because they're attacking critical race theory. Now, it's deeper than that.
Yes,
and he should be impeached. He should be gone. He should be gone. Why? Conflict of interest.
Yes.
His son-in-law.
Mm-hmm.
His son-in-law owns a company that publishes the critical race theory curriculum for schools.
Yeah.
Can you believe that?
Yeah.
I mean, can you believe where we are?
And he kept quiet about it.
He kept quiet, but still... It's not quiet anymore.
No.
So what are we going to do with it now? I mean, seriously, this is beyond the pale. I mean, that he is still even in his office is a travesty.
Yeah. Do you remember there was a vote in Minneapolis? Should we keep the police department or should we totally disband it and start a new department? Well, I actually agree with that in the case of the federal Justice Department. The entire Justice Department needs to be defunded, disbanded, get rid of all, because the entire department systemically is involved in a seditious effort and has been ever since Trump was on the campaign trail.
Well, and then you go to the NSA.
Mm-hmm.
NSA is corrupt.
Mm-hmm.
CIA.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, they're in collusion.
They're all they're awful. Awful.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny because initially, when Bradley Manning, now known as Chelsea.
Yes.
When Bradley Manning came up and Julian Assange revealed all of the
secrets. Gave Julian all those
details. And then we had Edward Snowden.
Yes.
OK. Okay. Now Assange, I had Assange and Manning, I had an issue with.
Mm-hmm.
Once we got to Edward Snowden. Mm-hmm. And what the NSA was doing, mm-hmm. spying on every American.
And lied to Congress about it.
Right. Forget lying. I mean, even before lying, just doing it.
Yes.
That should never happen.
Yeah.
And so I have been a fan of Edward Snowden.
I have too.
I do not think he's a traitor.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's a patriot.
Yes.
Sadly, he's been driven to Russia and seems to like it.
Well, you know.
He doesn't want to come home.
He's a whistleblower.
Yeah.
Isn't that
strange that mm-hmm. he can't come home for mm-hmm. being a whistleblower, mm-hmm. yet the colonel that mm-hmm. was supposedly the hero in outing Trump's phone call,
mm-hmm.
he's supposed to be a hero. Edward Snowden is a traitor.
Yeah.
Yeah, that kind of stuff. This is where we are in America right now, people. It's quite a shame.
Mm-hmm.
And, what's the reporter who's down in Ecuador? He lives in Ecuador now.
Hmm.
He's the one that helped Edward Snowden and Tucker Carlson.
Greenfield, I think? Greenfield? Greenfield.
It's something, it's a Jewish name. But he, he's on Tucker now, periodically, almost every week.
Okay.
He's very good.
Yes. Oh, very good.
He's very good, very sharp. And this is the thing, see, all of a sudden, we're starting to see the wheat separated from the chaff. Mm-hmm. Not in the spiritual sense, but the honest liberal or progressive from the pseudo.
Yeah.
Because I can't think of his name, but and Bill Maher. And others, your comedians, they're starting to realize, in other words, the true progressive, progressives are just write them off, forget them, because they're basically communists.
Yeah.
But a true liberal
mm-hmm.
who truly believes in less government mm-hmm. and keeping government in check, and so if we're not using government mm-hmm. for our own purposes, those guys are coming across, male and female, are coming across now and starting to realize what danger our nation is in when it comes to our liberties.
Yeah. Glenn Greenwald.
That's him. Greenwald.
Yeah.
Greenwald. Yeah, mm-hmm. that's him. He is a very brilliant guy.
Yes, he is.
Brilliant, brilliant man.
With integrity.
Yeah,
which is integrity. Hard to find in national media.
Yeah, and the other thing about it, and I don't say this, I'm not saying this to out him or negative, he's gay.
Okay.
In fact, he's married. He's got a husband.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it just shows you can't judge. I don't judge people by that. That people are always thinking conservatives are these
mm-hmm.
bigoted, racist, homophobes, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. That's the tag.
Yeah.
No, we're not. Glenn Greenwald is welcome on Fox News.
Yeah.
On Newsmax, any venue he would mm-hmm. want to go on because he's a straight shooter. He loves this country.
Yep.
Even though he can't come because he'll be arrested if he comes here to America.
Yeah. I mean,
and who's going to arrest him?
The
left.
Yeah, the swamp.
The swamp.
Yeah.
The progressives who claim they love homosexuals
Now keep in mind the reason why Snowden's fear for his life and is over and under protection of Russia is because he made the swamp look bad. He exposed the swamp for their violating of the U.S. Constitution. Yeah, that's it in a nutshell.
Yeah, it's very, very simple.
All right.
So, but you have another whistleblower that outed Merrick Garland that mm-hmm. he's spying, the FBI mm-hmm. is spying on parents.
Yeah.
Parents.
Mm-hmm.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
For trying to protect their children.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a shame. It's really sad. I don't know what to say about it. Other than, thank goodness that the parents are not backing down. I hope the movement continues to spread mm-hmm. as we get to. Now, New York, New Jersey, California. Well, I'm not ready to write off New Jersey. But New York and California, I'm ready to write them off. Just, mm-hmm. just bye. See ya. I don't even care about you. We cannot rely on them, okay? We have mm-hmm. to win the rest of the country.
Mm-hmm.
Then make sure the rest of the country doesn't go that way. For example, Texas, Florida, mm-hmm. the big states
mm-hmm.
are very important. And, of course, the heartland has to remain what they call the heartland.
But can I, I'm going to dig deeper on that. Where our problem is in the big metropolises of those states. Because you go upstate New York, it's very conservative. Yeah, yeah. You go inland from the coast, California is very, very conservative, yeah. Right? Pennsylvania, Trump actually won despite Philadelphia yeah. and their corruption. Yeah. So it's really a battle of the big urban Democrat leftist power centers versus the rest of the state. And it's true in all, it's true in Minnesota, my home state. I mean, Trump won 73 of the 88 counties mm-hmm. and still lost it twice, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. And it, so, yeah, this is.
But did he really?
Yeah, exactly.
See, that's a question we can't answer. We don't know.
Right.
Like you said, I mean, you're right. Mm-hmm. Even Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
Atlanta.
Yeah.
Okay, Atlanta is it. Mm-hmm. And they're counting all these votes. And I'll be honest with you, I guarantee you, even the black population is not voting Democrat.
I think
they're
so.
Not. They're not. They're the black community is being very much disparaged and done a disservice mm-hmm. by the media mm-hmm. in stereotyping that black people are just liberal.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. There are those, the talking heads you see, they're talking empty heads.
Yeah.
Like Joe Reed, you know, Joe Reed, the guy on MSNBC. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's always mm-hmm. making trouble. Looks like a woman, but it's a guy.
Oh, I thought it was Joy Reed.
Oh, it's Joe. It's Joe Reed.
Okay.
Yeah. Don't be fooled.
I get know. Where you're going.
But anyway, yeah. Joe Reed is mm-hmm. not only one of the most ignorant mm-hmm. females mm-hmm. I've ever come across, one of the most ignorant people mm-hmm. that I have ever come across. Mm-hmm. I mean, literally ignorant.
Yeah.
And yet somehow has a program on MSNBC, yeah. which tells you a lot about that station.
Sure.
I mean,
sure
they're getting nailed right and left.
I mean,
you saw the thing of the trial, which we'll get to here in a minute.
Yeah. And I want to say though, you know, our battle of different states. And again, I think it's more the urban versus rural because look at Austin.
Yeah.
How pathetic Austin, Texas is.
Houston, Dallas, San Antonio.
See, the
Texas
big cities.
Is in trouble. Texas.
Yeah.
Texas has some fighting to do.
But here's a dynamic I only saw less than a year ago. At this last February's Tulsa County Republican Convention, we didn't just see the token blacks there, such as guys like Eddie who would show up, right?
Hey.
Okay.
Hey.
No.
What we call a token, boy?
Okay. What we saw Honky. This last time, about 25% of the delegates, in other words, a higher percentage of the black community showed up than the white community, percentage-wise.
Yeah, yeah. No, I agree. It's changing. The thing about Tulsa, which is kind of a, and I think it's happening nationally, mm-hmm. which is hard to see, is as black people start moving out of the hood
mm-hmm.
and integrating into the general population, you're going to see more of them gravitate because all of a sudden their eyes are open. Mm-hmm. When you live in the hood, if you live in North Tulsa, you know, East Lubbock, South Dallas or mm-hmm. Oak Cliff, and you have these major ghettos,
mm-hmm.
then it's going to be portrayed that way.
Yeah.
Hey, when we come back, we've got to take a break. Julian is letting me know. I need to say that we want to talk about the whole thing. I have a way of reaching the black community.
Excellent.
And I hope somebody will listen to me.
I'm Jeff Davis with Just a Thought. From the world hindquarters of dubious information, it's Fake News Friday. There's a faked video of Kamala Harris saying that only vaccinated people are being hospitalized or died. She didn't say it. Speaking of which, authoritarian governments can deny things they actually did do by saying they're victims of deepfake videos, says Sam Gregory in Wired Magazine. Thousands of fake emails said to be coming from the FBI concerning a cyber threat are fake. A claim the Red Cross would not take blood plasma from COVID jab patients is false. President Biden keeps saying his spending plan is fully paid for, a claim many are challenging, but then again, the Treasury has a printing press, so is that old money or Monopoly money? Someone sneaked a fake credit card skimmer into a Costco, which meant they had to alert people to a potential data breach.
That'd be a deep discount.
Finally, a story saying Max Baer Jr. is the only surviving member of the Beverly Hillbillies TV show at 103 years young. And Max is only 83, but who's counting? Just a thought. I'm Jeff Davis.
All right, while Dave is fixing the other view, the other camera. Hey, I'm glad we got on that whole deal about the Black community, Hispanic community, Asian community. We can deal with that as well. The segmentation, as they call it, the balkanization of America, dividing us into groups, which is what the Democrats want. I think we talked about this before, and I'm going to say it again, and I'm going to keep preaching it until somebody that wants to or can do something about it does something about it. The way to reach the Black community, if anybody out there has money, if you want to give, this is where you give. I don't send it to me right now. Maybe we can set up a pack or something. But where we need to start emphasizing is buying time in Black media. Particularly Black radio.
Yeah.
You have Black radio stations all over America. Steve Harvey show, some of these big. Well, what you do, I doubt Steve Harvey is going to let us change him, pay him enough. We can't afford people like Steve Harvey and Michael Blaisdell is his name. I can't remember his name. Right? But anyway, they're these big nationally syndicated Black radio hosts that are on Black radio all over the country. And then they have local. But what we need to do is find these stations in these cities and tell them, here's X amount of money. And you run our ads.
Yeah.
We're buying ad time.
Yeah.
And then they have to take it. They have to, because by FCC rules, they have to take it. And that's where we need to start spending our money. The conservative radio, it's not a waste of money, but what I'm saying is we don't need to spend that much money there because there are people, they're going to vote that way anyway. We've got to start making inroads, and we've got to start attacking in the right way. So anyone that wants to take me up on it, hire me or let me volunteer, whatever, I honestly believe I have the answer on how to get into and reshape the thinking of Black America.
I agree. I think one guy that we need to see have a voice on to the Black media would be Bill Cosby. Because he said the things that everybody knows but weren't supposed to say.
Right, but he's now become, persona non grata.
Would he in that market, though?
That's a good question. Well, maybe that's why he's been attacked so badly, because he pulled the curtain back.
Yeah.
As people, exactly. I have to tell you, sir, like, for example, I was in my insurance business, I was at the home of a Black family or a Black person. And I started sharing about a lot of things that were going on, and it was a woman, and she says, "Oh man, you can't do that. Don't you know, we can't be airing our dirty laundry in front of white people."
In other words, let's hide our corruption.
Yeah, exactly. And I want to say, as if they don't know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Exactly. It's like, oh, we can't let white people, we'd be ashamed in front of white people. Oh, you think you're not already?
Right.
I mean, some of the stuff that the Black community is doing is ridiculous. It's as Spaceballs. It's ludicrous.
Yeah.
Ludicrous.
Yeah.
And there are ways to do ads, to do them in a really sophisticated manner, soft sell it, but just appraise people of the reality.
Yeah. Well, you know, he's not asking, but you and I last week finished a show talking a little bit about Henry Primo. Henry joined the Greenwood Chamber of Commerce and started a program of mentorship for Black entrepreneurs. And he tried his best to match up some successful, maybe retired businessmen in this community just to be there as free mentors. Because I think the biggest part of restoring the self-respect in whatever neighborhood is to for them to own their own shops. Instead of everybody shopping down at Dollar General, you know, some national chain, you've got to restore the identifying with entrepreneurship, and you'll get rid of looting.
I
think you go a long ways to that, because they don't identify the with that corporate chain.
See, I go back to Frederick Douglass and Booker T. Washington. Mm-hmm. He says it's at the bottom you have to start, not at the top. Mm-hmm. Entrepreneurship is ownership, mm-hmm. and you can't own something if you don't know what it means to own something. Mm-hmm. In other words, when I was with Farmers Insurance, mm-hmm. okay, they used to, anytime a black person mm-hmm. would interview, we'd have these OSU students about to graduate, mm-hmm. and they'd come in, they'd want an interview. And so they'd always send the black ones to me.
Yeah.
I wonder why.
Yeah.
But so anyway, and they would come in, and I would just tell them the reality mm-hmm. that you're working on commission, and it's however hard you work, however many people you're able to sell, that's how you make your money.
Yeah.
And it's a numbers game. Mm-hmm. So the person leaves, and then they go and speak to Arvest Bank, BOK, somebody, and they offer them mm-hmm. an account executive job. They call it an account executive, mm-hmm. right?
Salesman.
Right, where you get a little office and your name, a name tag and a mm-hmm. name on your door, you know. Mm-hmm. And you get to wear a suit.
Yeah.
And you get to, as the, I'm not going to go there. I had a joke. Mm-hmm. I was gonna about being important. But in,
you need a shovel. I can help you dig a little deeper.
If I was going to be important, I better look important. No, no, anyway. Oh, now see, now you've
done. Oh, you are in deep.
Anyway, excuse us. Maybe we can edit this.
This is my virtual popcorn.
Give me a shovel to dig out now. Anyway, what I was trying to say is so many of the young people, black young people, mm-hmm. it's all about image.
Yeah.
The image is so tarnished. The image is so beaten down mm-hmm. that they want to look important. It's more important to have a title of account executive mm-hmm. than to be just an insurance agent. Mm-hmm. And where you have to go out and work and make money instead of starting at the top. Mm-hmm. So when you talk about entrepreneurship, it all sounds great. Mm-hmm. But you know, because mm-hmm. you're in business for mm-hmm. yourself, mm-hmm. I know. Because I'm in business for myself, you don't just get to put a sign on your door and all mm-hmm. of a sudden you're a success.
Oh, yeah.
You got to go out. You got to do marketing. You got to sell your business. You got to mm-hmm. find clients. Then you take care of the client. Then you make them happy.
Yes.
And stay in touch.
And you're working 24/7.
24/7. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. So that's why I have a hard time anytime the word entrepreneurship comes mm-hmm. up, because it doesn't. It's when I took the cult apologetics under Walter mm-hmm. Martin, mm-hmm. he talked about how the cults redefine terms.
Yeah, they do.
So what means Christian to us mm-hmm. or what, you know, mm-hmm. Jesus yep. means to us, they just redefine so that when yep. you say it, they can agree. Oh, yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, I believe in that, but it's totally something else.
Yeah.
And that's kind of entrepreneurship to a black person means I get a nice job, a nice title, and I don't have to work hard.
Drive a nice car.
Drive a nice car, wear nice clothes.
Tricked out
car. But I don't have to, the bottom line is, I don't have to work hard.
Yeah.
I'm the boss.
Yeah.
So they want to, for some reason, magically, they're going to go to school, and then they're going to, or they're going to open shop, and they're a success. I met a, I'll say this real quickly. Years ago, I had a young black kid graduate mm-hmm. from OSU Tech in Okmulgee.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And very gifted, very good. And his degree was in, or certificate was in, auto mechanics. Mm-hmm. So he wanted to set up an auto shop. Mm-hmm. And of course, he set it up in North Tulsa. Mm-hmm. So he wanted me to insure this place. Mm-hmm. And he was full of hope. I mean, he was just so, and he was mm-hmm. going to give back to the community by setting up this automotive shop in North Tulsa. Mm-hmm. He went out of business. He 6 months later, a year later, he was gone. And I wanted to tell him, you're setting up in the wrong place. But, you know, what am I going to do? Here's how the, I don't know if we've talked about this. I've thought about it many times. I grew up in Philadelphia. And we talked about the Jewish corner store. Did we ever talk about that?
No, we haven't.
Okay. Almost every other, like, Quick Trip is on every other major intersection here in Tulsa. Well, that's how the Jewish corner stores were. The Jewish community, they owned these little shops.
Sure.
And they were like a Quick Trip without gas. It was just, you know, I used to buy my comic books, my candy, my cakes, and then they would have hot links and dill pickles, giant pickles, just really, and milk, and basically, it was like a convenience store.
Yeah. Yeah, I grew up with them in my hometown.
Right.
And their residency was usually behind the shop.
Right, exactly, or above it. Yeah, exactly. Well, what happened in cities, major cities, black people drove them out because they thought the Jews were stealing all of their money.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden, they were replaced by Muslim shops or yeah, exactly, or other.
Anybody willing to work hard?
Well, not necessarily.
Okay.
They just thought, you know, oh, we got the Jews out now, let's get our person in there. And they didn't know how to run the business like the Jewish community knew how to run the business.
It was hard work.
It was hard work, and it takes some skill.
Yeah.
Not everybody succeeds.
Yeah.
So, but what I learned is what the Jewish community did, they went where they knew the money was and which was underserved. So they went into the black community. And then what did they do? They took that community, that money, and they took it back to their community.
Yeah.
And they set up Jewish networks.
Yeah.
They took care of each other. They gave money to their synagogues, their businesses. They raised their kids. They made sure they succeeded. And so what I thought of this young kid and others, and this is if there's any black individuals out there that want to truly get into entrepreneurship, find a business that everybody needs and set it up in the suburbs. Then take your money, buy a house back in the black community if you want to, if you feel need to. Then you go back there and you spend your money back. So you make your money in the other community where the money is. Because black people, where are they shopping? Walmart.
Oh, yeah.
Target.
Ever since desegregation.
Exactly.
And that's really what killed, at least in North Tulsa, the black businesses.
It's,
because once people found out they can shop at Vanderburg's or Reed's and Dillard's, why, who's going to shop in North Tulsa? They'll go to the fancy shopping centers. They'll shop at Utica Square.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what killed him.
And it's crazy because you have shop after shop, business after business, trying to go into Peoria there at the Pine and Peoria.
Yeah.
And in North
Tulsa. It's failed.
And they'll fail because the people will want rather, they used to have a saying, the white man's ice is colder.
Yeah.
The water is sweeter.
Yeah.
Everything's better. And like you said, that's what, when integration hit, it devastated the black community.
Yeah.
And that has to, that mentality has to be changed to the point where entrepreneurship is not just about, I'm going to be a businessman just because I'm going to, because I say I'm a businessman or I'm an entrepreneur, I'm going to make money. It's crazy because I used to think, when I go back when I was in high school and college, that's what I thought I was going to do. And it's going to, you know, it's easy. Oh, yeah, I'm going to graduate and I'm just going to be successful.
But I want to throw a name out here.
Okay.
Last year, I interviewed a candidate for mayor, Ty Walker, owns Wanda J's restaurant in Black Wall Street. I'm bringing up him. I didn't agree with all his politics, but what I'm saying is he serves as a role model in that community as somebody who runs a business, and listen, if you stay in the restaurant business, you are a hard worker, period, because it's tough work, you know? And we need more businessmen like Ty Walker. Now, I have seen black food establishments do pretty well, and they've been some of the most impressive people I know as fellow Tulsans. You know, and so I'm saying there are ways that the little guy can do well.
Let me ask you a question. Those people that have been successful, where have you seen them?
You know, I've been talking to them, social media and stuff. They talk about, you know, what works.
But I mean, where are they located?
Well, Ty is down on Black Wall Street, you know, Greenwood.
Right, but where's Black Wall Street, really?
Okay, right, exactly. It's in the interdispersal loop, so it's downtown.
Well, it's right by City Hall. Right,
but there's a few of them scattered. They're, you know, and well, listen,
I would say any black business that succeeds is not in the black community.
That's a good point.
Do you know who Wanda J is? Ty's
It was his mother, right?
Not was, is his mother.
Okay, yes, okay.
And his mother still runs one, or his sister runs one.
Mm-hmm.
They just changed the name. It's called Evelyn's.
Mm-hmm.
And it's up at the airport. It's
okay.
North of the airport.
That's right.
And that's where all of the airport workers go eat.
Mm-hmm.
If you've never eaten at Evelyn's, they're on North, it's off of 44th
is
Street.
Is it by the Air and Space Museum?
Yeah,
down that
exactly.
Road?
Right.
Oh, I've eaten there.
You just, yeah, that's
sure.
Evelyn's. That's Ty's sister and his mom.
Yeah.
His mom is the one who runs the cash register.
Michael Bates and I ate there one time. It was when we were both covering, Mike Huckabee did a rally there in 08.
Yeah.
It is right across the road from that restaurant.
Right.
Great restaurant.
It
great
is very good. It's people, busloads come there from Oklahoma City all around just to eat their chicken on Thursday.
I had no idea it was the same.
Yeah, so that's Wanda J. Mm-hmm. That's actually the Wanda J the one that Ty has at Greenwood runs.
Yeah.
If you look at any successful black establishment, food establishment, mm-hmm. and so forth, it's always located outside the hood.
There you go.
Okay. And, you know, Elmer's, right? Elmer's was the big...
Oh, it'd be bad. Elmer's barbecue.
Yeah, the barbecue. It'd be bad. Yeah.
Yeah, he was down at 42nd in Peoria. No, he's out of business there.
Peoria.
They've ended there.
Yeah.
But yeah.
But yeah. But I think that what happened, they died.
Yeah.
I mean, the owners died out and the kids, mm-hmm. and they didn't want to admit. So there are a lot of other mitigating circumstances on those type of things. But again, that's another problem with a lot of being a business person.
To quote Thomas Edison, the reason most people miss opportunity is because it comes disguised in denim overalls and looks an awful lot like hard work. That's what Thomas Edison said.
That's a good one. That is a real good one.
Yes.
Disguised in where's overalls? That's good. Oh, we could go on this forever.
Yep.
But anyway, I just wanted to say that let's get to the really meat of what we need to talk about today. Julian, how much time we got?
That's 18 minutes.
18?
We're good.
Oh, good. We're good. Because I wanted to cover two major cases this week.
Mm-hmm.
I'll start with the local one first.
Yeah.
Julius Jones.
Yes.
It's a local story that has become a national story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Oklahoma
Julius
story.
Jones, 19-year-old, accused and convicted of murder.
With eyewitness testimony.
With eyewitness testimony. But the whole narrative has changed.
Mm-hmm.
He's this poor, innocent OU student who just happened to be wrongly convicted.
Mm-hmm.
So, movie stars, football players, Baker Mayfield's gotten involved.
All those people who sat in the jury trial and witnessed all of it.
Have spoken with the family of the deceased. And all right. Right. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
Just as what's her name? Laura Ingraham had the book Shut Up and Sing. I want to say, just shut up and play football, especially you, Baker, since your team seems to be back to its old losing ways.
Yeah.
But Governor Stitt, I've demoted him. Governor Stitt has decided to commute the sentence, but with the recommendation of the parole board. Okay, the parole board wanted him to commute this sentence, and he...
To life with parole.
He commuted the sentence, the death sentence, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's just stick. Focus.
Yeah.
Focus.
Mm-hmm.
So, Governor Stitt has commuted the death sentence, and he's convicted him of, or not, but he's upheld life without parole.
Yes.
Which now is not enough. which I knew was coming in the first place.
Of course not. Yeah, you knuckle under.
My personal feeling, and believe it or not, I am not really a proponent of the death penalty. Mm-hmm. Okay. It has to be used very sparingly and with a true conviction. Mm-hmm. Now, so many of the facts didn't come out in, you know, in the revisionist history. Mm-hmm. The fact that the gun was found in his house, in his drawer, wrapped in his shirt with his fingerprints on it. Mm-hmm. But he didn't do it. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, yeah. That's a whole... Yeah. The girlfriend that he had a witness said, yeah, he was someplace and he was with her, says he wasn't. Mm-hmm. His friend, or the other guy who was there, says he's the one who shot him. I mean, what are you supposed to do as a juror, right? I mean, the severance coming at you.
That's where I'm getting at, is the jury.
The jury. Mm-hmm. And you can now, in today's system, juries are not allowed to deliberate on evidence anymore. They're supposed to go on, well, the oppression of a people yeah. for hundreds of years, right? So we're going to even it up.
And will there be rioting? Will my my home be doxxed? I mean, all these things. But I've got to say this.
Yeah, please.
You spend several weeks in a trial, mm-hmm. give up your income, give up your, you know, your daily life, your social life, give up all of that.
And it's a major decision. You're holding someone's life in your hands.
Yeah. Now, first of all 12 jurors have to agree beyond reasonable doubt that he's guilty. That's the first part. Second part, and only can a death penalty happen if there's a second part, is that all 12 jurors agree that the death penalty is the proper adjudication. If even one says, no, I think life without parole, right. then guess what he gets? Life without parole. One person can nullify
right.
that. But you had all those jurors do diligence, they're there, and then Governor Stitt says, no, I think I know better. I have a problem with that. I really do. And listen, Governor Stitt, you know I'm saying your praises when you deserve it. This one, I'm going to objectively say no, or at least if you do, have the gumption to stand up and say, here's why, and be honest with us. Why? You know more than the jurors.
Yeah, and that was my position, and that is my position. Mm-hmm. However, in thinking about everything, I'm not worried about the rioting. I'm not worried about the
repercussions. Can't be.
No, we can't. Cannot. We got to push back, which we'll get to in a minute.
Yeah.
But the problem that he had was the parole board. Mm-hmm. Okay, the parole and pardon commission. It's hard to have a panel of people mm-hmm. come and say, this is what, in studying the case and so forth, we're convinced that we need to go ahead mm-hmm. and not execute this person. So the governor was between a rock and a hard place. Mm-hmm. And I even wrote earlier that I disagree with the governor's. But as I thought more about it, in essence, really, life without the possibility of parole may be worse than death.
It could be.
I mean,
in certain
if a person's bound for hell, I guess it's better than hell. But at the same time, as far as life, your life is now that prison. That is your life. So I think what the governor did, he listened to all parties concerned. And it took some, now listen, it took some guts because he knew that he's going to catch it from people like you and me and others.
Yeah.
So I don't think it was a chicken move.
I think he needs to at least elaborate on here's why.
And he may. I mean, you know, it just happened.
Yeah,
it just happened earlier this week, right? So plus there was a lot of other stuff going on at the same time. So I think he will. Mm-hmm. But I'm with you. Yeah. I thought that he should have just.
Yeah.
Let it go on and let the execution take place and take the heat and show strength.
Yeah.
And then through that, then let everything.
Can I suggest a reform in this? I think that the judge hearing the case should keep in sealed documents who the jurors are, so that when that pardon parole board wants to review it, that if any of those jurors want to come give their perspective, pardon parole board ought to listen to those jurors.
That's true. That's true.
I think that would be a brilliant move, because do you know any of the pardon parole board? I don't.
No, I don't.
All I know is they're government appointed, usually political appointments. I want to know what was Bill Buckley said? I'd rather be governed by the first 100 names in the New York phone book than by any of the legislature politicians we have today.
Yeah.
Now, you'd have a lot of Abrahamsons, but, you know.
Abrahamsons. All right. We're going to be back in a minute. This is Fresh Black Coffee, and we'll be back.
Yeah.
I'm Jeff Davis with Just a Thought. In the United States, we have a profound belief that we don't have political prisoners. Citizens in China, Cuba, Venezuela, and other oppressive countries get locked up for being dissidents, stuck inside four walls with no hope. The so-called insurrection on January 6th created an ugly mark against the U.S. government, as a number of Americans remain locked up under inhumane conditions for many months. This even after the FBI said there was no organized insurrection. Meanwhile, Democrats' lust for political blood exceeds their desire to work for the American people. But political retribution includes such things as an FBI raid of members of Project Veritas, whose raids allegedly leaked by the FBI to the New York Times, a company being sued by Project Veritas for defamation. Now Steve Bannon is being targeted. With elements of Attorney General Merrick Garland's FBI being a political weapon against Americans, it paints a very nasty and frightening picture of authoritarianism, which includes violations of the U.S. Constitution. Just a thought. I'm Jeff Davis.
Yeah, I had to pour water on Dave to bring him down from his high horse. Yeah. He was all heated up about Governor Stitt. No, I was also thinking that he should have continued and gone with the execution. However, in seeing the way everything has played out, I understand why he did and how he did it and so forth. And for the sake of the state, I mean, honestly, again, I get back to the fact that there's a fate worse than death, and that is spending the rest of your... Now, here's the problem, though. Here's the other side to it, okay? You know how much is enough for the left?
Never.
A little bit more.
Yeah.
Right.
Just a little more.
Just a little more. And so, they've already... I mean, he commuted his death sentence, okay? Lets him live. And what's happening? The NAACP and ministers and all these people in Oklahoma City, the black community, is now up in arms because he didn't just free him.
Yeah.
They thought that when he was commuting the death penalty, it meant they're going to let him out.
Yeah, pardon.
Not pardon. No, it wasn't a pardon.
Yeah.
He's just going to spend the rest of his life in prison.
Yep.
So, again, in a sense, it's worse. And I don't know. And I have a feeling I'm still going to be right, because they're going to chip away and chip away and attack him and attack him for still keeping him in prison for the rest of his life.
Now, you know how the leftists decide which death sentences to oppose?
Yeah.
It's criteria. Whichever one comes up next, that's the one that's the most egregious.
Yeah. Well, yeah. But they realize they have better luck with a black person than a white man.
Oh, of course.
So if you're a white guy sitting on death row,
bend
your, just what you do, say a prayer, put your head down between your legs as far as it'll go, and kiss your butt goodbye.
Now I lay me down to sleep.
Yeah, because they're not going to go very far on trying to save you.
Yeah.
Which brings me to, or us to, the other big case of the week. Which was kind of a surprise, actually, but a pleasant surprise, and that is the Kyle Rittenhouse case. That judge, that's a judge there.
Thumbs up.
He was laying into the prosecutors. And I mean, come on. It was such a ridiculous case in the first place. I can't even believe. Here's what's funny, too. Initially, a lot of people were asking for a change of venue. I thought they should have had a change of venue, bring it out of Kenosha, where it's the local heated area, and they would be all upset and worried about riots and so forth. But they left it there, and it turns out that the jury of Kenosha and the judge came out with a pretty good verdict.
Yeah. Now, keep in mind, the 12 that get selected are 12 that have already been screened by the prosecution and by the defense for what? For their fairness, right? So we found 12 fair people. Right. They took basically a whole week to do due diligence. I don't know, but I would think they probably stalled it out just for the appearance of we took our time. That's where I'm at. Let's speculate.
Oh, yeah. That would be funny. So what you're saying is they had the decision made after the first 30 minutes, but they said, well, let's just hang out here for a week.
In principle, I'd say within 2 hours.
Did anybody bring the backgammon game?
Yeah.
Hey,
yeah.
Get the Monopoly board out.
No, I think, first of all, these people are, they care about their own place in the community, right?
Yeah.
So they're also wanting to make sure that they give the appearance that they didn't rush to judgment either way. Mm-hmm. I think that's an important thing.
No, it is. It is very important. Mm-hmm. But in the end, I'm so happy that they actually listened to the testimony.
Mm-hmm.
They weighed the facts.
Yeah.
And, I mean, honestly, it's the only true, just verdict that could have. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've all seen the video.
Yeah.
We've all seen the video, right?
Yeah.
Of Kyle being chased, pushed down,
mm-hmm.
and set upon by these guys. Mm-hmm. He pulls his gun up and saves his own. I mean, he literally saved his own life. The one guy was going to beat him with a skateboard. Guy had a knife. One had a gun. I mean, in the end,
yeah.
there was nothing else he could do. And then what did he do? He turned himself into the police.
Yeah. Or at least that's what he's trying to do
yeah.
when he got into another confrontation.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah. No, I am very, very proud of the jury in Kenosha, Wisconsin for what mm-hmm. they did and how they did it. Now,
yeah,
along comes Joe Reed again. Joe Reed and all of those nonsensical yeah. people over there at MSNBC and a lot of them at CNN. Oh. And then, of course, Mayor de Blasio and the former disgraced governor of New York, by the way, Cuomo.
Oh, because they were all there.
Fredo Cuomo. Yeah, they were. Yeah. They kind of throw their little 2 cents in there, yeah. which is about, and then it's an inflated 2 cents,
it's
by the way.
It's posturing.
Oh, it, sure it yeah. is. Sure it is. I cannot wait for de Blasio to be Gonio. I mean, serious. That is just ridiculous. Yeah. He is the worst politician I think we've seen this century, only to be superseded by our superintendent of education yeah. in Oklahoma.
Yeah.
Okay. Here's what's funny. Okay. So Joy Hoffmeister is coming out against Kevin Stitt
mm-hmm.
to run for governor. She switched yeah. parties to become a Democrat.
Yeah.
And in that, in doing so, she now is attacking Governor Stitt for being a Republican
mm-hmm.
and attacking him for education in Oklahoma. Now, Kevin Stitt's been there, what?
3 years.
3 years? Mm-hmm. How long has she been yeah. Superintendent of Education?
Yeah, she's 8+. Yeah, almost 8.
Right. And where's education at?
Yeah.
It looks what has like she done with education?
Yeah.
Come on. Come well, on, this no, lady, no, this you lady is unfit for any public office. Any, I say that. She's not even fit to be on the PTA.
Well, keep in mind, her resume was not empty. You know, she was a school board member of a local school board.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
That's important.
That's yeah. important.
Yeah, she had yeah. a resume.
Yeah. I was asked to be to run for school board and wouldn't do it.
Yeah.
I probably should have.
But speaking of the governor's race, I'm now backing off, even though I got a pretty good knowledge that, you know, TW Shannon is going to run for governor. I'm now suspicious he's actually going to be running for
Well, I've heard, yeah, since I'm glad you brought that up because yeah. I've been a bit chided for I don't know where in the heck did we even get that information. I'm trying to remember where I saw it. I promise you I saw where he was declaring to be. He didn't file officially. I don't know if anybody's officially filed.
No,
but as I said, he was running, and now as I've spoken to some other people that said he's not running, which would be good because I like TW. Okay, he's a friend. He's a good guy, but. I really disagreed with him doing this for tearing the party apart. It needs to be all hands on deck.
What I think's happening. And by the way, it was three legislators that told a source of mine that. And when I pressed him further, I found out, this is what we think. Well, now, I talked to TW Shannon last spring. He wouldn't tell me what he's running for, but he confirmed me. He says, yeah, there is something I'm interested, but I'm not ready to talk about.
Hopefully it's Senate. Again.
No, because that's what I asked him. I said, are you going to take on Langford? And he said, no. But he said, there is something I'm interested in. Here's what I think it is. I think we may be at the end of the Tom Cole legacy in CD4.
Oh.
Now, something happened this week in redistricting, because that's where they were at the Capitol for a special session, because the Census Bureau couldn't get it done on time last spring, right? So my projection was that they were going to give Lawton and that whole southwestern part of Oklahoma over to Frank Lucas, add it to CD3. Meanwhile, we're going to take Tom Cole and push his boundaries all the way to the downtown of Oklahoma City so the whole south side would be part of CD4. And then we were going to give a little bit of Lincoln, Logan County, maybe Canadian County to CD5 to kind of diversify it to be a little more rural. The only thing that didn't happen, according to my projections, the only thing that changed was they gave this corridor of southern Oklahoma City, not to Tom Cole, but to Frank Lucas, so that Tom Cole could hang on to Lawton. Guess who was born and raised in Lawton? TW Shannon.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So I think
but
that's his base.
If Congressman Cole is retiring, because right. Cole is responsible for TD being in politics.
Yeah, he was a staffer.
He recruited him so maybe Tom Cole is ready to call it quits.
Here's another thing. And I talked to the
I would vehemently support him.
Yeah.
I would gladly support him for that, represent that.
Well, I talked to our majority floor leader, John Eccles. He's been a friend for a number of years. He told me, he says, if ever the time came that Tom Cole was no longer running for Congress, I'm definitely interested. He's from Cleveland County, the north side, John Eccles. That would set up an Eccles versus Shannon primary. Now, I talked to my friend, the vice chair of the Republican Party, Shane Jemison, who is Chickasaw, and he just flat out says, no, Chickasaw is going to vote for the Chickasaw, T.W. Shannon. Mm-hmm. So that's
T.W. has got a lot of bases covered.
Yeah. Now, the only
Black
other,
Indian.
Yeah. The only other part of it, just to wrap up the whole report on redistricting, is CD1, Kevin Hearn, Tulsa Metro, now became truly a metro district. We got rid of Washington County completely, half of Wagner County. Now the line is on the Verdigris River. Everything to the east goes over to Mullen. Washington County goes over to Mullen. Instead, now Kevin Hearn takes Sepulpa, the greater Sepulpa surrounding area. So now we truly have the more populous chunk of Creek County is in CD1. So it's very much a concise metropolitan area.
Hmm.
So that's my report from the Capitol.
All right.
Yep.
All right.
Yep.
Thank you for that.
All right.
No, but we do. I don't know if I'm ready to apologize yet, but I will say I may have jumped the gun.
Well, I think it was a plausible thing to look at.
Yeah,
there were a lot of signals that TW still continues to make that looks like it.
Yeah, that he's running for something.
And I will say this, the tribes would love to see TW Shannon take on Stitt, because the tribes do not like Stitt.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. No. After the whole taxation of the gambling taxation, the casino taxes and so on. Yeah. No, that's definitely something we need to be looking at. Wow, man. You know, things have gotten so bad. I'll jump back to national stuff. that Bill Maher, mm-hmm. a true liberal, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, he's out there.
Yeah, know? In and the finer sense of the word, at times.
At times. And mm-hmm. one of those is now. He has begun railing against the toxic Democrats, yeah. particularly AOC.
Yes.
And so he is final in his final show of the year this time, he went after Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, mm-hmm. AOC, mm-hmm. and he asked her to appear on a future telecast. Mm-hmm. And so anyway, in his monologue, he attempted to point the Democrats in the right direction mm-hmm. after their loss in Virginia, of mm-hmm. course, and so forth. But anyway, he cited commentary from James Carville. James Carville is another yeah. one who said, you guys,
yeah.
you know, I was out there, but That's you right. guys are out
yep.
there.
And, yep.
and so anyway, but Carville basically said the party lost on stupid wokeness.
Yep.
They call it wokeness. And so what AOC says that wokeness is an idea that old white men, exclusively older people using that. And then Maher jumped over and said, you even used it in mm-hmm. your own campaign.
Yeah.
The wokeness mm-hmm. and calling on that. So he basically has called out AOC. And he's also said that the Democrats are insane in the different policies yeah. and things they're pushing.
Yeah.
That no person with a true sense of Americanism, a sense of intelligence, essentially, yeah. would support this kind of stuff because oh, yeah. 'cause they're way out there. The yeah. Democrats have taken it. And they're not quitting.
Yeah.
Which let me ask you about the budget. Mm-hmm. They have now, the Democrats have passed in Congress. It hasn't gone to the Senate yet. The House, yeah. right. Yeah. The House has decided they're going to go on with the old, I'm going to call it old Biden, the Biden budget.
Yeah, the Build Back Bankrupt. yeah, it's, you know, and it's a party line thing. And they need 60 votes in the Senate. How are you going to do that? And here's the thing.
Well, unless they get Manchin demand, Manchin no, and Sinema.
No. They would have to throw out the rules. That's called the nuclear option. And here's the brilliance of Senator McConnell, Mitch McConnell. Mitch. He agreed to help them on a previous, I think it was called the continuing resolution budget.
If they promise.
And they used their last reconciliation. Remember, they only get a couple each year according to the rules. Where they only need 50 votes, and they've used them now. And Mitch kind of pushed him into using it, so they can't use it on this. This is, if my understanding's correct.
So what you're saying, they have to have 67.
They have to, no, 60. 60.
I'm sorry, 60, yeah.
Yes,
yeah, yeah.
And it's called a closure rule, to stop discussing. Because
right.
otherwise, you essentially have a filibuster of the whole.
Right.
And so this is going to be an interesting thing. Because I don't see where they get 60, you know. Because I don't even think they get guys like Manchin or the gal who's trying to look like Sinema. A conservative. Sinema, yeah.
yeah. Yeah, I have to. Well, I don't think she's just trying to look like a conservative. I think they pushed her that way.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing that I think happens to a lot of these Democrats, mm-hmm. especially the ones that
yeah.
switch over because yeah. they literally get pushed over mm-hmm. by some of the crazies yeah. in the party.
Yep.
I mean, it just gets to the point where I'm sorry, I might as well be a Republican. Mm-hmm. If I'm going to take this abuse, yeah. why should I stay here yeah. and support you people when you're out of your minds?
Yeah.
Like, and this is what bothers me, okay?
Yeah.
You talk about January 6th,
mm-hmm.
where they were in the Capitol Rotunda,
mm-hmm.
but the Congress was shipped elsewhere, right? They were like a mile away, over mm-hmm. a mile away. And yet that was this horrible, AOC's crying that her mm-hmm. life was in danger. And mm-hmm. come on, give us a break. Mm-hmm. Well, but you've got these ladies that in the Russell building or one of the congressional buildings followed Christian Sinema into the bathroom.
Yeah.
Into the ladies' bathroom. Yeah. And they were out there harassing the yep. lady while she's going to the toilet.
Yeah.
And, oh, it's all okay. It's
Biden says it's fine.
Yeah, yeah. It's just protest.
Yeah.
It's the First Amendment.
Yes.
To go annoy somebody while they're on the toilet. I mean, come on. That kind of stuff. I mean, and here's the beauty of it, though. America sees it.
Oh, yeah.
America sees what's going on, and they don't like it.
Yeah.
And that's what Bill Maher is talking about.
It goes back to the quotes. He says,
y'all people have lost your cotton-picking minds.
The famous question asked to Joe McCarthy, Senator, have you lost your sense of dignity? Have you no shame? I mean, some things just, I forget, I'm paraphrasing.
No, that is the line. It's a true line. And I don't want to go to McCarthy. I was just thinking, should we? Nah, we don't have time. Yeah. But McCarthy actually wasn't wrong.
Right.
That's the tragedy of it. They talk about McCarthy.
But the
even
left,
Republicans, even Republicans now are talking about the shame of Joe McCarthy.
Yeah.
Joe McCarthy was just a person that had vision. He saw where we were headed.
Fact is, John Kennedy walked out of a banquet one night when he was candidate for president because somebody stood up. He says, we pride ourselves here that we have some school. And says, we've not created any Joe McCarthy's nor Elder Hiss's. And he walked out. John Kennedy says, I will not stand here. Well, the name of a patriot is being compared with that of a traitor.
Wow. Yeah. I've never heard that. That's a great line.
Yeah. Pat Buchanan told the story.
You know, the thing too, I mean, if you think about it, Charlton Heston, Ronald Reagan, they were Democrats.
Yes.
Strong Democrats.
Mm-hmm.
But they saw what was happening.
Sure.
John Cox
sat here 2 weeks ago. He saw the light. Right. It's time to get out.
Right. Yep. With that, David.
Yeah. Oh, I got
what's your name again? Julian. By the way, Julian's back.
I got one more big attaboy goes to the commissioner for Oklahoma County, who just announced he's running for district attorney of Oklahoma County. Very powerful. We can get into it in a future show. Kevin Kelvey, the former state representative and big friend of mine, he is running, and I think he's going to win. District Attorney, we're saying goodbye to David Prater.
Well, good.
Yeah.
Good. Yep. Yeah. As I was saying, though, Julian's back. Welcome back, Julian. We've been busy and out of it. Have you heard any? Oh, did you go see? One last thing. Did you go see our friend Henry Primo? Did you see him this
week? I'm scheduled to see him this weekend.
Okay. Well, tell him hi from us.
Yes.
And we're continuing
I reached out to his wife. I said, you know, I've got to do my corporal works of mercy. I said, I'm in your neighborhood almost every day. Let me know if I can do anything. And they've got friends that are taking care of them. Family's really stepping up.
Yes, good.
But they're quality people. But right. I'm glad to see Julian back again. Pay him more. So.
Which he believes it. All right, everybody. Hey, thank you so much for tuning in. Hopefully there's some news you can use. And we'll hopefully see you next week. God bless. Goodbye.